Hi there, and welcome to another episode of Mr. Carlson's Lab. In this video, we're going to take a look at an old vacuum tube amplifier that has a really neat history behind it. We're going to also bring this amplifier back to life again. I'll get into that history just after we get started. This is a mass power amplifier, or MAAS as it's spelt, and these amplifiers have a really neat history. This amplifier was used in carillon service. Now you might be asking yourself, what is carillon service? Well, way back in the day when churches had bell towers, bells were very expensive to fit in these towers, and depending on when the church was made, if it was made during the war, a lot of the metals were going to the war effort. So the church would buy pre-recorded bells, and they would play those pre-recorded bells through this large power amplifier here. This power amplifier would power large speakers up in the top of the bell tower to announce to the town that church was in. So as you can see, the amplifier needs to be relatively large to do that because, you know, this thing is announcing this to an entire town. And that's why you see so many 6L6s and it has two rectifiers. And there's a lot of thought that went into this particular amplifier, and you could call it built-in redundancy. So if one of the 6L6s basically was to die or go flat, the thing would run off three no problems. The configuration that this phase inverter is in, this is just a phase inverter input, nothing more. If one of the tubes were to die in the phase inverter, it would still play through one tube. If one rectifier was to die, it would still play with one rectifier at reduced volume. Basically, the only really weak link would be is if this particular tube was to go away, and they're using this as a form of pass regulation, and I'll get into explaining that here in just a little bit. So a very neat amplifier to own. Not only that, they're extremely simple to bring back to life. Now, they require quite a drive level in order to make this thing, you know, if you're going to use this to play music, you're going to need a little bit of a, you know, a pre-driver stage to make this thing play. Again, it only has phase inverter input. But nonetheless, lots of iron in the audio transformer, and they sound really, really nice. So let's take a look at the underside of one of these things, and I'll show you exactly what to change to make one of these things come back to life again. One of the most interesting aspects of removing the bottom panel off of an amplifier or any older piece of gear like this is looking inside and seeing what the engineers were thinking when they designed and built this older gear. And it really is quite fascinating because you can tell so much from just looking at this right here. We can even see a little bit of the history of the amplifier as well, and I'll explain this as I go along here. So for all you solid state guys out there that are looking in the bottom of this amplifier, you're probably saying, "Ah, that looks like a rat's nest." Well, this is known as point-to-point wiring, and they did this for years and years and years, and it was quite effective. Nothing wrong with it. This is actually quite clean. They loomed the wires together here and kept everything nice and uniform. So when I look in the bottom of this amplifier, the very first thing that I see is an incredibly simple design. There's hardly anything in this chassis. Huge, wide open chassis. Everything can basically breathe nice and easily inside the bottom here. You can see that, you know, very low component count, very simple design. What does all of this spell? Well, it spells dependability. That's exactly what they were looking for when they were designing these things. These amplifiers were designed basically as a set it and forget it thing. A lot of these things were placed in the upper portion of a bell tower and just left alone for years and years and years. And they would run 24 hours a day, 7 days a week without failure. Some of these things are in very bad condition when I've seen these things. Like, you see this has got a lot of corrosion on the chassis here and rust. You can see some rust up in here. We can see some liquid has come down through the tube socket here and onto the components here and over here. There's a really good chance that that's either mouse or rat urine, something like that. A lot of the times when you purchase an amplifier like this, it'll have pigeon crap on them or some form of bird crap on them. And again, it's just because they're not directly exposed to the elements, but, you know, they are up in the top of a bell tower and they have louvers, things like that. And, you know, some, you know, birds and stuff get up in there. And, you know, of course, rats, they're looking for heat in the wintertime and things like that. And they make these things into their little home. So, again, if you're going to try and purchase something like that, or something like this amplifier here, be prepared to be dealing with this kind of stuff. I've seen these things almost rotted completely through. The odd thing here is that the paint that these guys used on the chassis here is absolutely bulletproof. This paint looks absolutely fresh on most of these amplifiers, but when you look inside, you're like, whoa, you know, it's almost rotted right through to the paint in some of these things, but the paint, it just stays fresh. So whoever chose the paint and whoever did the prep for these things definitely did a really good job. Just absolutely indestructible paint they put on these chassis. So way back in the day, working on something like this for a serviceman would have basically been a serviceman's dream. Everything is so well laid out, you'd probably spend 20 minutes on the job and the thing would be up and running again. Maybe replace a vacuum tube or capacitor, resistor, maybe replace the, you know, the indicator lamp and, you know, off he goes again. Probably the worst part of his job would be climbing up the inside of that bell tower to probably get to the amplifier or something like that. Now, not all of these things were placed in the bell tower. Some of them were placed, you know, in remote locations, but, you know, in cleaner locations. Like this one here hasn't really seen all that rough of a life. But again, some of these things are just, you know, absolutely rusted to crap inside, right? So another thing that I can see just by looking at the bottom portion of this is that the designers of this amplifier were thinking pretty much the same way that the designers of the older broadcast equipment were thinking. So the older broadcast transmitters are built very much like this. Again, a lot of spacing between the components here. Everything is very well laid out and loomed and everything like that. In fact, I have a bunch of broadcast transmitters, and in the future, I'll bring the camera inside the broadcast transmitter with me, because I can stand inside the transmitter. I have a couple of them here. You can look inside the broadcast transmitter and I'll show you exactly why I'm comparing what I see here to the inside of a piece of gear like that as well. You can let me know in the comments below if you're interested in seeing the inside of some of these older broadcast transmitters. So very well laid out. And again, you know, just designed for dependability. So the failure points in an amplifier like this are pretty much the same failure points as you find in modern day equipment. Capacitors. Capacitors are the problem. These things here, they leak internally. So they leak electrically inside. Basically, they're turning into resistors. The idea of these capacitors is to block the DC from the plate of the previous stage from getting onto the grid of the audio output tube, which would be a 6L6 in this particular application right here. So if you wanted to mimic the failure point of this capacitor right now with a modern capacitor, you would replace this with a polypropylene equivalent, and then you would put a 1 megohm resistor across it, and that would be the failure point. So technically, these things are turning into resistors inside just because the paper is breaking down. These are paper and foil capacitors inside. So these leak electrically. Now, if you have a paper and oil capacitor or PIO capacitor, a lot of the times they'll leak actually physically and electrically as well. So they all have to go. Now, these capacitors here are a real sore spot for a lot of the older gear. It's a pink capacitor with yellow writing on them, and they're called tiny chief capacitors. I call them tiny grief capacitors because they just destroy output tubes. They kill output transformers, burn out cathode resistors, and do all sorts of bad things. So anytime you see a pink tiny grief capacitor, they gotta go. Replace them with a suitable polypropylene equivalent or, you know, something that's modern that will do the job. Of the same value. Now, in this amplifier here, there are a lot of other things that should be checked over as well before you want to try and put this thing into service. Again, you can see in this one here, you know, we've had some form of a liquid run down here onto these resistors. You probably would just want to replace these resistors, not even bother testing these things. You know, the ones that look okay like this, you know, there's no real fluid that have leaked on them. You want to check them. Most of these resistors you can check right in circuit. You don't even need to disconnect them because tubes are a relatively high impedance device. And these are high impedance circuits here. So most of these things you can just place your ohmmeter across them and check them in circuit like that. There'll be very few that you'll have to remove from circuit to check. If you wanted to check these capacitors, you need a special tester to do that. Modern capacitor testers won't test for leakage in these things. So they'll test for capacitance and, you know, real common, another tester is an ESR tester, things like that. These require a special tester. So these testers can be found at, you know, ham radio swap meets and things like that for usually very cheap. They have an iTube in them. So you can find them, you know, $10, $15, $20, something like that. But here's the thing. If you buy a capacitor tester, it's going to need to be recapped as well before you use it. So you'll need to recap the capacitor tester before you, you know, come in here and, you know, go using it to test anything. Again, whenever you see capacitors like this, you know, you don't even really need to bother testing them. You know, just get rid of them and replace them. The nice thing about having a capacitor tester around is that some of the older capacitors were actually a form of poly-style capacitor, and they still test good. So, you know, if you were unsure about that particular style of capacitor, having a capacitor tester and, you know, testing them and finding no leakage amongst a whole bunch of these capacitors would most likely indicate that you've found an early type of poly-style capacitor. Another real sore spot in these things is the electrolytic capacitors here. So there's four electrolytic capacitors inside this one can here, and as you can see, this is most likely boiled, and it's actually blown some of the electrolyte out of the bottom portion of the capacitor here around one of the pins. So if you were to power up an amplifier like this, plug it in and turn it on, there's a really good chance that you would burn out both of the rectifier tubes. You don't want to take that chance. So you don't even power up equipment like this. So what you're going to do with this is you're going to disconnect this entire capacitor here, put an internal tie strip over here, and put in a bunch of new capacitors over here to replace this. Now, it's absolutely fine to leave this capacitor in here. It's not going to leak anymore. I get lots of questions from people saying, oh, you know, it looks like it's leaking around the pin there and it's going to drip on the chassis. No, this is going to remain dry and nothing is going to happen. You can leave this thing in here. It'll just act as a dummy capacitor on the top portion of the chassis, and it just looks factory that way when you leave that thing in there. So again, no reason to change this. If you want to change it with a capacitor that doesn't have any leakage, that's fine as well. You know, whatever makes you feel comfortable. Some people even just hollow them completely out and just clip the can back on here again. One thing you're going to have to be warned of when you do that, though, is a lot of the times, you see how these are kind of twisted in here? Well, when these are twisted onto the chassis here, there's a ring that's crimped into the bottom portion of that aluminum shell. And if you want to hollow out the inside of the capacitor, if you remove that crimp, this ring will come out. So again, for my own purposes, I just leave them in here, and I've never had any grief. They don't drip, they don't leak. I've had some of these things around 15, 20 years that have looked like that, and they don't do anything. They just stay exactly the same. So again, you know, just personal preference. So what else can I tell you about the inside of this thing here? These holes that you see here are for a thing called convection cooling. And how convection cooling works is the components on the upper portion of the chassis are getting very hot and heat rises. So when heat rises, it pulls cooler air from the bottom. Now the bottom panel that fits on the chassis of this amplifier here has louvers in it, much like the large louvers in the side here. So as the heat from the tubes is rising and the heat from the transformer is rising, it's going to pull cool air in from the bottom portion of the chassis here, and it's going to cool everything in the bottom side. So in larger amplifiers and big tube gear, and even in some of their larger solid state equipment that has lots and lots of really large pass transistors, or, you know, output transistors, whatever you want to call them, in the chassis, they will have holes like this around components that get hot as well. Again, that's just a convection cool around those parts and pieces. You can see that they've added in a resistor here on the indicator lamp. That's just to drop the voltage on the indicator lamp down so that it doesn't glow so bright. So just reducing the voltage to these light bulbs just even a little bit will extend their life incredibly. And that's what they do. And I wouldn't be surprised if this light bulb here is the original and it's still glowing. So that's the way they used to enhance the life of the older incandescent lights. We can see that some form of a tech has been in here and tried to replace this control at some time, and they've done a real sloppy job about it. These are normally a splined shaft on this, and this is a solid shaft that would require a set screw on the upper portion of this control. So somebody's done a pretty messy job in the bottom portion of this chassis here. So, you know, so much to, you know, see by basically just looking at this little. It really does tell an entire story here. So what I'm going to do next here is I'm going to remove one of these capacitors here, and I'll show you exactly what I mean by electrically leaking. I have my capacitor leakage tester across this tiny grief capacitor here. So the negative lead of my capacitor tester is just attached to this end because this end of the capacitor is still in circuit. I've disconnected this end of the tiny grief capacitor and I've attached the positive lead of my capacitor checker to this end here. The reason that I've taken the capacitor out of circuit here is because capacitance leakage testers are very sensitive. And if this is attached to a resistor that's running through some other circuitry, it might fool the capacitor tester into giving me an incorrect reading. So that's why I have this one end completely open. So this over here is the capacitor leakage tester. And how this works is I have a little switch down here that I click to leakage. So that's on leakage now. And what it's doing is it's putting 3 volts across the capacitor, and you can see the eye is open, so that's fine. Now, when I move this up to 6 volts, you'll see it close briefly for a moment and then open again. As the eye is closed, it's charging the capacitor, and then when this opens, that means that it's charged. So the capacitor's charged right now. So when it's charging, it looks like excessive leakage. Just look at it that way. So I'll move this up to 10 volts, it'll charge again and open. So it's not excessively leaking at 10 volts. Now this tiny grief capacitor is rated for 600 volts. So we'll go up to 15 volts, 25 volts. You can see it's getting really slow now. I'll go to 50 volts. And I think that is at the point to where this is excessively leaking. This should have been open. If I was to put a new capacitor across this, it's basically closed open, that fast. In fact, I'll go get a brand new 0.1 microfarad capacitor at 630 volts, and I'll show you the difference here. Here's a brand new 0.1 microfarad capacitor rated at 630 volts. This is a poly-style capacitor. And we'll see how this goes. 3 volts, 6, so we'll just go up to 100. I'll just put this on discharge and I'll show you how quickly that moves. So here we go, 100. So I'll just turn this right up to 600 volts. That's how a new capacitor looks. So discharge, and then I'll apply the voltage to the capacitor right now. That's a brand new 0.1. That's how quickly that eye opens. So that gives you an idea of how incredibly leaky those old capacitors are. Right at 50 volts, it won't even open. 25, it's so slow in its action. So really, you know, the thing is turning into a resistor at that point. The nice thing about owning a few of these mass amplifiers is I can show you the before and after recapping at the same time. I own 3 of these amplifiers. 2 of the amplifiers I have recapped and I use them as daily drivers here in the lab. So they're not shelf queens or Lucky Loos, they're used all the time for listening to music as I sit here at the bench and work on whatever I'm working on at the moment. So these things have been absolutely wonderful, no hiccups, they don't fail, they just work and work and work, you know, nothing goes wrong with them. They're very dependable. In fact, you could kind of look at it as maybe even a little bit boring. So they just work and work and work. You don't ever have to go inside or do anything. So I'll explain a little bit about this amplifier here too. This tells a bit of a story as well. And in fact, there's quite a bit of a story on this amp here. First of all, I'll start with the electrolytic capacitor. You can see on this one here how all the wires are attached to it still. This one here, I've completely disconnected all the wires. I've installed a terminal tie strip here. I've taken the wires and fastened them to the top portion of the eyelets here on the terminal tie strip. The capacitors are soldered in to the rivet portion of that terminal tie strip just below. So that allows me to very quickly and easily replace any of these electrolytic capacitors if they fail. A matter of moments and I can install a brand new capacitor. Now these have been here for a long period of time. Absolutely no issues whatsoever, but you know, down the road if something does go wrong, very, very quick replacement. Much, much easier than replacing an entire can here. So 3 of the electrolytic capacitors out of the can are right here. The 4th one is right up here on the cathodes of the 6L6 tubes. That's the nice thing about using modern components, is you can install them closer to where they need to be. The original one, of course, they ran a wire off down over into here, into the capacitor can over here. So again, You know, it's kind of nice having the modern components quite a bit smaller, and you can just very easily replace these things. You don't need to replace four of them at one time, right? Now, this one tells quite a bit of a story, actually. If you look at the cathode resistor on this one here, and you look at the cathode resistor on this one here, you can see that the ceramic coating is rippled on this 100 ohm resistor, where this one here still looks pretty nice. The resistor is absolutely fine. The nichrome wire is fine. It still reads 100 ohms. But this tells quite a story with the original tubes that came with the amplifier. The original ST style tubes were all flat, and I mean flat, no emission whatsoever. You pull them out, put them into a tube tester, they glow, right? You know, they glow like a normal tube, but you hit test, doesn't even budge off the replace line. And every single tube on the chassis was like that. Reason being is because these things get forgotten about. They're usually in some area that they're not seen, like in the top of a bell tower or hidden away somewhere in a church, and they just forget, you know, people forget about them. They just get left on 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. So what happens is these capacitors, the tiny grief capacitors, get so incredibly leaky that, of course, what they're doing now is they're starting to change the bias point of the 6L6s. The 6L6s draw excessive current, and they're starting to get really stressed out because the capacitor is getting leakier and leakier. And then what happens is this resistor, the nichrome wire on this particular resistor, looks like it was probably glowing orange because it actually rippled the ceramic coating on the top. And of course, that makes the tubes just go flat, you know, burns them right out. So in fact, I was actually pretty lucky that the audio output transformer in this amplifier didn't go away. So every single tube, all the rectifiers, the pass tube over here, the phase inverter tubes, completely flat. That just, that the only reason that something like that would happen is it would have to have been left on 24 hours a day for probably years in order to do that. So again, you know, when you get one of these things, if it has a full complement of tubes in it, be very prepared to replace all of them. Now, these here use the 6L6G tubes. They don't use the GC style tubes. They are directly replaceable, but I put the 6L6Gs back in. The 6L6G is very close or very similar to an 807, but it doesn't have the cap on the top. Or a 1625, if you prefer. The 1625 is the 12-volt heater version of an 807. So the old 6L6Gs, here, I'll pull one out of the top. 6L6Gs, they look like this. They have the ST style on them. If you can see a little G illuminated right there. The new ones are the GCs. They have a little bit better dissipation ratings, but I want to keep this, you know, as close to original as I can on the upper portion of the chassis. These tubes look really nice as well. Again, an 807 has a plate cap on the top. Instead of having the plate cap on the bottom, they're designed for higher voltage. They're used in transmitting use and some, you know, larger audio amplifiers, the 807 and the 1625 for that fact as well. Heathkits used 1625s in their modulator section in like the DX100s and things like that. So again, quite a story that these things tell. All the resistors were pretty much fine. I don't think I replaced one single resistor in here. Everything was good. Even this one that had gotten hot still reads right at 100 ohms. I left it in, and you know, I recapped these things long time ago. No problems whatsoever. Again, not a hiccup. I did replace the dial lamp in here. You can see on this one here, they have one of the elongated bulbs, like the 47 style lamp over here. You'll see that the filament is way down here, but the little jewel light or the little jewel is over here. So basically the filament isn't even in front of the jewel, so it doesn't really look like it's on. So you have to use these shorter rounded bulbs where the filament is directly in front of the lamp. So I notice a lot of people do that in a lot of gear. They just throw a 47 in there, but some of these are set up for these, you know, smaller rounded bulbs. So I replaced those in both of them, and you know, it makes the jewel light look really nice and bright when they're on. Let's see, what else can I tell you? I sprayed some contact cleaner in the potentiometers. This switch here was absolutely fine, no issues. I put a brand new line cord on here. In fact, I used, I'll just move this 6L6 out of the way here. I used a reproduction cloth cord. Looks really nice on there. Now, a lot of people ask me all the time, they say, don't you feel safer running a three-wire cord? No, I don't. But if you feel more comfortable with using a three-wire cord on your amplifiers, by all means, do it. That's personal preference. These things were not issued with three-wire cords. So I just put the two wire cord back on this amplifier again. Again, it's personal preference. If you feel safer using a three wire cord, by all means do that. So there's a few reasons why three wire cords can kind of interfere with audio service. You get ground loops and things like that, and sometimes they impose a little bit of hum here and there. So, you know, again, personal preference, whatever you feel comfortable with. I replaced the fuse. The fuse was okay, but was a little bit corroded, so I got rid of that. That's pretty much about it. You know, just cleaned up inside and turned out really nice. You know, just again, got rid of all the tiny grief capacitors, put in the appropriate poly style caps, and yeah, they work just for long periods of time. This amplifier probably won't need servicing now for, I don't know, another 40 years or something like that. Probably the only thing that will ever need to be replaced would be a vacuum tube on the top if one of them was to go flat. I'm going to take a voltage measurement at the output of the rectifier tubes at the very first filter capacitor, which is this capacitor here. I'll be taking that voltage measurement at this point right here with a very well insulated probe, and I'll show you why here in just a moment. So if we take a look at the vacuum tube voltmeter up here, you can see the scale here says 5.0, 4.5, 4.0, 3.5, and so on. That's 500, 450, 400, 350 volts, and so on. So I'll grab my well-insulated probe, take a measurement right here, and as you can see, we're just over 400 volts DC. This entire amplifier is full of that voltage everywhere, and there's quite a bit of current available at that point as well. So whenever you're working on an amplifier like this, you need to be aware that those voltages are all over the place. It's not like a solid state amplifier, a lot different than transistorized equipment. So all the red wires that you can see that there's red wires attached here. So all the red wires that you see all over in here are basically that voltage. And then the orange wires are a reduced voltage, not much lower, but reduced. And that's coming off of this. Basically, it's a crude form of regulation. This is a pass tube over here, and they're regulating the screen grid voltage for the 6L6 is basically to, you know, lower distortion and things like that. So it's a nice design, you know, crude form of regulation. They could have added a few more tubes and really regulated it and really lowered distortion. But again, this thing's going to probably end up being in a bell tower or something. So, you know, even at that, it's probably not all that incredibly important, but they did their homework and they did a nice job. So again, if you're working on an amplifier like this or any type of vacuum tube gear, be very, very careful because that voltage is extremely high. And if you come across it, it might be your last time. So if you're following along, you're doing so at your own risk. Just take care. The moment of truth has arrived for this mass power amplifier. So how many watts do you think this amplifier will make, distortion included? Let's find out. So I have the output of my signal generator attached to the phase inverter input right here. The output transformer is coupled across an 8-ohm load, so it's an 8-ohm dummy load that's basically connected to these two wires here. And I have my Agilent U3402 meter as a direct readout, and that's also across that 8-ohm load. So as I move my signal generator up, this will track it nice and quick. So here we go. Let's see how many watts this thing makes. I don't know if you can hear that 1,000 cycle tone. That's the audio transformer making that tone. Pretty loud. Watts. Not too bad. That would be driven into full distortion as well. So the amplifier is rated for 50 watts. Now here's the catch with this. These 6L6 tubes that I'm using are pulse. I got an entire bag full of these ST-style tubes. They're all pretty good, so I matched up a whole bunch of really strong ones and put them in these amplifiers. So the tubes aren't even fresh, and it's still making over 60 watts, and that, of course, is into distortion. So with a brand new quad of 6L6s, I would imagine this amplifier would exceed 50 watts quite nicely. So I would say that Mass underrated this amplifier, and that's really nice to see. So this amplifier pretty much takes everything my signal generator can put out to bring this thing up to maximum output power. And that's because there is no preamplification stage in this amplifier. Basically, the 6J5s are, both of them are acting as phase inverters. So what I'm thinking of doing is removing the 6J5s and putting in two 6SN7s on the top. So one 6SN7 would act as a phase inverter, maybe a long tail pair or something like that. And I would have one stage of preamplification in front of it, and that would make this much more friendly to preamplifiers. Probably, you know, fool around with the feedback as well. I'll do some measurements and see how much feedback they've included and maybe tweak that as well in the future here. Thanks for stopping by the lab today. Hope you enjoyed this episode involving this vacuum tube audio amplifier. If you're interested in learning more about vacuum tube audio amplifiers, vacuum tube equipment, or just electronics in general, you might want to check out my ongoing electronics course on Patreon. I'll link that just below this video, right about here in the description. So if you click on that link, it should take you right there. If you enjoyed this video, you can let me know by giving me a big thumbs up and hang around. There'll be many more videos just like this coming in the very near future. So until next time, take care. Bye for now.